Although the term industrial design was only coined at the beginning of the 20th century, design has its origins millennia before. If it's not nature, it has been designed. Design has been there since the very beginning. It is the cornerstone of civilizations, as everything that people ever touched, felt, seen or used that was created by man has been designed. Examples of great designers of the past: Archimedes, Leonardo da Vinci, Thomas Edison, and Henry Royce. Since the creation of industrial design, there have been many a household name, with Henry Dreyfuss, Raymond Lowy, and Mies van der Rohe, to name but a few. Arts and Crafts was led by Morris & Co., a decorative arts firm headed by the renowned textile designer and artist, William Morris. Arts and Crafts ran from the 1860s to around 1910. It was a reaction against the mechanisation of the production process and the ways in which factories were run. Arts and Crafts is all about craftsmanship, about making things by hand, tradesmen taking pride in the making of an object. It also glorified the construction process, often making simple forms and having the construction of the objects obvious. The intention of Arts and Crafts was to have handmade products for everyone. However, due to the intensive labour involved in creating products such as tables, chairs and wallpaper by hand, these products were far too expensive for the vast majority of people, and as such, it was only available to the wealthy. Art Nouveau, on the other hand, started in the 1890s and ran until approximately 1910. The name Art Nouveau came from the gallery Le Maison de l'Art Nouveau. This style is very decorative in contrast to Arts and Crafts. Prime examples of the Art Nouveau style include the Grand Palais and the metro stations of Paris. Art Nouveau relied on skilled craftsmen creating complex decorative forms by hand. This proved to be the downfall of the style, as like Arts and Crafts, the handcrafted nature made their creations expensive. The Art Deco movement was started around the 1920s in Paris. Shortly after this, the term Art Deco was coined in 1925, after an exhibition in Paris which celebrated the International Exhibition of Modern Decorative and Industrial Arts. Art Deco was also quite unlike the design movement Art Nouveau, as it rejected the flowing curves that were also common in the Art Nouveau products. Much of the work that was produced in the Art Deco movement was influenced by the idea of constructivism, cubism, modernism, and futurism. The inspiration from the style came from Aztec and ancient Egyptian forms. Art Deco was a purely decorative movement that had no political or philosophical intentions. The movement died out around the 1930s and 40s, only to become more popular several decades later in the 60s. Famous pieces of work that were created in the Art Deco era were the Empire State Building, the Chrysler Building, and the Rockefeller Center of New York. Other, perhaps less famous pieces of work that were designed and built in the Art Deco era can be found all over the world, from Poland and Germany to Australia. Bauhaus started in 1919, which was shortly after the Arts and Crafts movement. Bauhaus, which translates as School of Building, was founded by Walter Gropius, who created Bauhaus with the intention that he could combine two schools that he was the head teacher for. Between the times of 1919 and 1933, the school experienced three different head teachers. The three different leaders were Walter Gropius, leading from 1919 to 1928, Hans Meyer, leading from 1928 to 1930, and Mies van der Rohe, leading from 1930 to 1933, when it was shut down due to the Nazi regime. The school was originally set up to combine all different areas of design and bring them together so students could study the different areas. Although the founder was an architect by trade, there wasn't actually an architecture department until a few years after the school was founded. Between the years that the school was open, it produced an amount of great work from the students, and from the teachers at the school also. For instance, Mies van der Rohe's Barcelona chair, and Walter Gropius was responsible for the design of the building that the school moved into in 1925. The war. Europe's and the world's darkest age, with huge loss of life and everlasting pain. This is one event in history that affected all aspects of life, including industrial design, even into the post-war period. Due to the large amounts of materials and resources needed for the war effort, less raw materials were available for domestic products. Many factories and companies went into the manufacturing of war materials, such as weapons and ammunition. This left a gap in the manufacturing design of domestic products, as all efforts and materials were put into the war effort. The war, however, placed a huge emphasis on mass production. This was on a scale that the world had never seen before, and this spread to the design and manufacture of domestic products. Design during the war concentrated on keeping costs down and materials down. Design was often very simple, with no decoration as this wasted material. Thus, a much more economical approach was adopted to increase the efficiency of the production. However, the war provided the world with much advancement in technology and science. The war gave the world the microwave and the computer, not to mention the Tupperware container and the jet plane. These all spread to everyday life, which meant they had to be designed for domestic use. This gave design a boom as there was an eagerness to turn these new technologies from weapons of war to everyday domestic products. Designers such as Henry Dreyfuss took full advantage of these advancements with the design of many products, including the typical house frame. The war left unrepairable scars and huge loss of life. But from the ashes, born was a new world, full of new design the world had never seen. Just before the war, a new movement emerged called Streamline Modern. This movement started before the war and survived the war years and existed to benefit greatly from the advancements the war gave. The Streamline Modern movement is a reaction to Art Deco and the austere economic times produced by the Wall Street crash of 1929. Although Art Deco and Streamline Modern are not necessarily opposites, key figures in the movement saw Art Deco as a fraud and falsely modern. Unlike Art Deco, Streamline Modern relied upon simple aerodynamic curves rather than the sharp angles and fancy ornaments of Art Deco. Materials such as exotic wooden stones were replaced with cement and glass. Perhaps the most famous designer from the movement was Raymond Loewy, who was responsible for the design of the Shell Petrol Company logo, as well as the Coca-Cola bottle. The movement exploited technological advancements in materials, particularly in aluminium and bakelite. The movement relied heavily on the use of streamlining. The movement aimed to raise people's spirits, and streamlining came to signify wealth and the exciting future, and is perhaps one of the reasons the movement was so successful. After the war, the world faced austere economic times, which affected design. However, the Streamline Modern movement continued into the 1950s. Designers have been influenced greatly by the modernism movement for decades. The source of modernism ideals originate from the 19th century. However, it only emerged as a strong school of thought in the aftermath of the First World War, and then continued into the 1960s. An ideal form was what the designers inspired by modernism aspired to achieve within their products. By an ideal form, it was meant that the product would have total appeal, so that it could bypass differences in social position and taste, so that it would become timeless. The method designers took to create products of an ideal form meant the designers' decisions were based upon a rational assessment of the problem they were attempting to end with their product. Products needed to be fit for the modern age. Past solutions were rejected, so that new technologies and materials could be used. Designers believed that a correct design was possible, so they wished to use the most advanced technology and materials that were available to help them achieve this. The designer Dieter Rams created the 10 Principles of Design. This is an exemplary explanation of the rational assessment modernist designers go through. Modernist designers also believe that the structural integrity is what should create the aesthetic of a product. In the 1950s, the ideals of modernism were starting to be criticized and questioned. Designers began to feel that it was not correct to search for an ideal form or a universal solution, and that they should work towards individual tastes and preferences of consumers. This change in ideals became known as post-modernism. Modernist ideals said that products needed a predetermined meaning before it reaches the user. This means that the use and meaning of an object is to be constant, and from this there is a possibility of an absolute and universal meaning to be attached to the product. Post-modernism thought, however, challenges this view. It is said that an object is not able to speak for itself, but is in fact spoken for by its social and political context. This means that what people might associate with a product is in fact the position it is viewed in. The aesthetic appeal of the product is seen as a constantly changing characteristic of the product, relative to the circumstances in which the product is to be consumed. This shows that to postmodernists, the meaning of the product is discovered in the circumstances that surround it, rather than in an intrinsic quality of the product itself. postmodernists argue that there could never be just one perfect aesthetic solution to the design brief, and there are many different solutions to a problem based on the context and circumstances. Postmodernism says that the preference of form for designers and users of the product is determined on factors such as their location, economic status, and educational background. They believe there can be no correct aesthetic of the product, and that there are many forms for a product. Because of the changes in the ways which products and designing have been viewed in postmodernism, theorists began to see that a key determinant in the creation of a meaning to a product was consumption. The products we consume are seen as indications of our lifestyle and social group to the outside world. Cars, clothes, food, and even everyday objects are now an expression of our lifestyle choices, whereas before it was thought people were defined by their occupation. Now consumers are encouraged to define themselves through the products they choose to buy and use. One of the main differences between postmodernist ideals and the ideals of modernism is that the meanings associated with the products are not fixed, but can be used and manipulated by the consumer and designer. Some products get many meanings during their lifetime. For example, a student owning a 1970s airline bag isn't saying they're a regular air traveler, but is more likely an ironic statement about how cool they are. This is just one of many examples in which the product's meaning has changed because of the context it is viewed in. Designers now have to target a particular area of the market and appeal to them, and also look towards future trends and understand what will appeal to whom. One such postmodernist designer to rebel against the ideals of the modernist design movement is Luigi Collani. By incorporating humour and wit when designing products, Collani is possibly one of the most renowned postmodernist designers. Those against him accuse him of being a design entertainer, but there are others who close on worship him as a philosopher and a genius. One of Luigi Collani's greatest achievements was the car, the Mazda MX-5, which has helped inspire many designers of cars since. Memphis is a design movement that was started in Milan by Ettore Sottsass in 1981. It predominantly operated from 1981 to 1987. However, Memphis still has an effect on the modern design world, with Christian Dior using Memphis as an inspiration for his Haute Couture collection fashion show. Being part of postmodernism, Memphis followed the principles of form over function. This meant that some Memphis products sacrificed function in order to make the product aesthetically pleasing, and in some cases, extravagant. Key designers to come from the Memphis movement were Ettore Sottsass, who is famous for the design of the Carlton dresser and the founding of Memphis. Other key designers include Danny Lane, who designed the famous yet extravagant Etrusian chair, and Marco Zanini, who is famous for designing the Dublin sofa. A founding principle of Memphis's fun approach was the use of primary colours within their designs. This use of colour added extravagance, fun, and excitement to their designs. Colour was also used in a practical way. Colour was to remind audiences of their childhood days in order to make them feel happy and relieve the stress of adult life and work. Despite the forms of Memphis, comparisons can be drawn between that of Memphis and Bauhaus. Although Memphis took form over function, throughout Memphis's design, products used simple geometric shapes, which was one of the founding laws of Bauhaus and similar design. Design has always been shaped by the concerns of the time. Today we face the problems surrounding sustainability. From people to animals, the environment as a whole, design's evolving to nurture and protect our world. Some products are intensely practical, such as Life Straw for third world countries, which purifies the water that flows through it. Others are more of a statement, like the Garden Bench by Drew Design, made entirely of recycled renewable materials. Due to this, it's also completely biodegradable. By using less materials and compacting them, production and transportation energy is saved. The Honey Pop Chair by Tokuyin Yashioka is made of nothing but the thinnest paper. Perhaps the design company most famous for its flat pack products and eco-friendly outlook is IKEA. Founded in Sweden in 1943 by Ingvar Kamprad when he was just 17, it has gone on to spread stores across the globe, where it has revolutionised the homeware industry. The self-service cuts down on the employment costs, and the money saved can be filtered back into the products themselves. IKEA states that their vision is to create a better everyday life for many people, a goal which they strive towards with strict eco-regulations and partnerships with both the WWF and UNICEF. IKEA owns 67 wind turbines worldwide and is always looking to power their stores by alternative means. And yet their best eco-development remains in their designs. With multifunctional, lightweight and low-waste homeware, IKEA is leading the way in mass-produced eco-friendly design. Another way of creating sustainable products is to make them longer-lasting, either through durability or easy upgrades. Cradle-to-cradle design is a mentality that embraces both of these methods. Stoke is a particular advocate of this, with designs such as the Trip Trap High Chair and the exploratory pushchair. In fact, as in the Industrial Revolution, technology pushes all aspects of design. Developments such as nanotechnology, which allow us to tailor-make materials at molecular levels, create incredibly light structures out of common carbon. Drawing inspiration from nature has allowed us to create self-cleaning paints and self-healing plastics, using processes observed in the lotus leaf. Eggshell polymers have been used to make packaging which degrades into harmless silica. Computer-controlled manufacturing prototyping methods, particularly stereolithography, allow us to transfer digital models straight to the real world. Patrick Jolin used this in his Materialize project, and many other amazing new technologies are now being developed from the spark of an idea, to prototype, to beloved product. On the 1st of April 1976, Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak released the Apple I computer and started Apple Computers. The Apple I was the first computer with a single circuit board, making history. In 1984, the Macintosh was released after a single $1.5 million advert played in December 1983, and then again in the third quarter of the Super Bowl. The advertisement was relayed over the news in other forms and was seen by millions before the release date. The advert became a conversation piece for the year, as the public were expecting to see the best computer made in their lifetime. The advert led the public to believe that an innovative piece of technology was about to come into play. After the product had been sold, Steve Wozniak went back to college and the board at Apple decided to keep on John Sculley as CEO, and Steve Jobs left before being fired. Amazingly, the technology at the time consisted of memory of only 1 megabyte, weighing 16.5 pounds, and would set people back a cool $2,495. Production only ran from January 1984 to October 1985. The computer was, however, the beginning of the Mac OS system, with Mac OS 1.0. In many people's eyes, Apple has been the company that has brought out the best technologies and products before any other company, including Microsoft. For instance, they were the first company to invest in producing a tablet. We can no doubt expect more great things from the company, so what can we expect from the future? Something to watch out for in the future is a new material called graphene. This is a material that was only discovered recently, however it has been in use for centuries in its raw form. Graphene comes from graphite, the same material that is used in pencils. This material is only one molecule thick, however it is the strongest material known to science. Its future uses include even smaller computer chips, transistors at less than a thousandth of a millimeter thick, and smaller, higher capacity batteries. Graphene also has the potential, due to its conductive properties, to create a screen that is the computer. The whole computer, battery, processor, and display, in a see-through, strong, and flexible form. This is not a fantasy. In February 2010, IBM created transistors out of graphene at a minuscule 240 nanometers each. Using graphene, transparent, flexible displays are already being developed. One final thing that graphene will do for us in our lifetime is carbon nanotubes. These are simply rolled up sheets of graphene. These carbon nanotubes can be used to create polymers to form a super version of carbon fibre, if you will. Carbon nanotubes have a sixth the weight of steel and 150 times its tensile strength, about 1,000 times more efficient than steel in a strength to weight comparison. This may replace Kevlar as anti-ballistic armour, or even be used as hyper-strong anti-armour penetrating substance. Imagine cutting tools that sharpen themselves as they wear. With the development of these materials, projects like the space elevator will become a reality, not merely a pipe dream. With technologies like this, the future will be more than a little bit exciting. Keep your eyes open. And remember the material graphene. In our lifetime, it will reshape our lives.